Let's just say, if you were making an American-made Taylor guitar,
yeah,
how many
yeah. It would see 6 robots.
Okay, that was a little dramatic, but in this video, we are going to be talking about robots. Hopefully not ones that will gain sentience and send us into a dystopian techno-apocalypse. These ones just build guitars. We live in the age of technology. In the last 20 years alone, we as a species have achieved feats we could only think of as futuristic dreamscapes. With cars that can drive themselves and artificial minds that can write full novels with a single prompt. For the most part, if there's an industry that has remained relatively unchanged over the last 100 years or so, it's the acoustic guitar making business. Almost every brand still makes acoustic guitars out of wood and a few other materials. Tyler Guitars are a brand doing things differently. We've already made a couple of videos where we take a broader look at how Tyler has industrialized the guitar making process in their own way, as well as an in-depth look into what defines a Tyler guitar. If you haven't already watched them, we'd highly recommend it. What you really need to know before we dig into what robots do at Tyler Guitars is that Tyler has made a business out of making their guitars a little differently from their peers. Spending years constantly innovating and automating their build process, allowing their models and identity to be shaped around the tools they have available to them, Tyler has come a very long way in reinventing and establishing the acoustic guitar and their company as a whole in their own way. So, let's meet Tyler.
My name's Tyler Robertson. I'm the robotics and automation engineer at Tyler Guitars. And me and my team are responsible for any kind of automated equipment at the factory, even so far as the warehouse, distribution, anything that might require software or hardware to automate a process.
Tyler, alongside his team, play a huge part in allowing the well-oiled machine that is Tyler Guitars to function in the way that it does. We'll talk about all of that shortly, but first, let's talk about robots.
So if you consider robots at Tyler, then we've been using robots for 20 years. Actually, a little bit more than that. We started using robots over 20 years ago and then really had them into production after 20 years. But if you consider CNC, numerical controlled milling machines, then automation at Tyler has been in place for 30 plus years. A robot is 6 motors and encoders that moves something around in space. Who wouldn't want that? You know, any woodworker on the planet would love to have a robot in the shop. It's a manipulator that can repeatedly put something in the same place over and over. They're a dream that way for manufacturing.
Robots at Tyler perfectly supplement their production to allow for more uniformity in every guitar they build. Renowned for their consistency from guitar to guitar, robots offer a level of perfection and intricacy in measurement and execution that is simply impossible to achieve in the hands of a human. Of course, automated production is not a new thing. Across the world, thousands of industries rely on almost entirely automated factories to produce a high quantity of a product for their own respective markets. Tyler are, of course, not breaking ground on that front. As we mentioned earlier, when it comes to acoustic guitars, things have remained relatively unchanged. For more than 100 years, acoustic guitars have mostly been built in the same way. Your market standard CNC machines and the like are present in most factories. For the most part though, high-end, respectable acoustic brands generally rely on the same techniques used over the last century.
CAD drawing is now the standard for doing any kind of manufacturing. You start with a CAD model, which is just a computer drawing of your product geometry. That allows you to make quick design changes, and it's what engineers do now instead of drafting by hand, usually. You know, there's some exceptions. What I want to do is take that digital representation of our guitar as a product and drive our automation processes with that CAD model. It's the defining structure that goes throughout the process. You have your design, so drive your automation and your programming with that design.
Where Tyler are different is the bespoke nature of the machinery they use to make guitars. Taylor's robots are developed in-house with their models and designs in mind to ensure there is a sense of unity between the purpose of the machine or tool with the requirements of the guitar. With this in mind, Taylor can manufacture guitars that are precise to 1/1000th of an inch. Their margin of error is largely non-existent. Through years of research, development, and feedback, Taylor has streamlined much of their process through ensuring that certain quirks and errors that usually come with guitar building don't set them back by programming their machinery alongside their guitars from the ground up.
For our robots, I do something called offline programming, which is taking the CAD model and then generating the program from that through a series of software packages that we've bought or that I've created that allow us to create programs that is more accurate to the original design intent of the guitar.
This means that Taylor can focus more time on making the best guitars they possibly can without wasting too much time on writing ROMs that normally crop up in the process. Taylor has not necessarily developed their automated process to simply produce more guitars in shorter timescales. They have done so to enhance the work already done by luthiers since the inception of the instrument, whilst doing away with the margin of human error almost entirely. But how have they got to the point they are at now? Taylor's robotics and automation processes have not happened overnight. As explained in our previous video, bespoke tooling and equipment has slowly been developed over time alongside their guitars to constantly improve on the guitars they make. A big question at this point, why has no other guitar brand really done what Taylor are doing with robots before? One of the largest challenges any guitar maker faces when building instruments, especially in high quantities for a global market, is dealing with wood. For many, that is just a challenge they don't want to face. In comparison, a smartphone on a production line is made from many controllable materials. The chips, circuit boards, and parts used are almost identical unit to unit. Ensuring the different elements of those products will play nice in every assembly is much less of a concern. The processor chip isn't going to change in size or rigidity from phone to phone. Wood, on the other hand, is an organic material with many variables. No two pieces are the same. Take two separate pieces of rosewood sourced from different trees. They could have entirely different grain patterns. Cuts could vary in measurement, resonance, tonality, colour. The list goes on. So how do Taylor program their systems and machinery around an organic material such as wood?
Oof, that's the big question. I mean, that's a daily question. It's tough. It's tough. You dial it in for sometimes we have programs that are dependent on the wood. For instance, when you're buffing, you generate a lot of heat. And some wood has more resin in it and can handle that heat better. There's some species of wood that are easier to bend than others. So there are usually what happens is we make a separate program. There's some parameter that you have to change for that wood. We do our best if we don't have to, if we can design with intent to accommodate those differences, then we'll do that. Like if there's a sensor we can use somehow, or our RFID tags, which we use throughout the factory, can indicate what type of wood is in which guitar, which can then allow us to choose different programs. So we're building a machine right now where the wood is very crucial to the machine. So we have to know what the species of wood is going into that machine, so then we can change some speed and you know, force parameters to go along with that. So it's a bit of a dance. And luckily, most wood follows some sort of species dependent criteria. You know, maple is very maple-like and ebony is quite ebony-like, but it's a challenge. And I think that's the difference between automating with intent and automating carefully and choosing which projects you automate as well.
You'd think that by automating the build process, Taylor would have to think and do less in the pre-production phases of creating a new model. What actually happens is that Taylor has to spend even more time ensuring that the designs they have put together are perfect in the preparation stages to allow for the benefits of automation down the line.
And I think of that as one of the like the heartbeat of what Tyler Guitars is, because we build all of our tooling to build and to produce every one of our designs. It's like every single part of every design needs a way to prepare the material, to hold the material, to hold it while you do your next cuts, to assemble it, to finish it. Every aspect has to be thought of and controlled.
Standard work docs we have now, documentation. We don't do a thing without, we don't put a process with everything having. It's like, we'll start that next Wednesday. Why can't you start tomorrow? Because we have to make the standard work doc.
In a way, Taylor's production method actually creates more work. A symptom of this process is that every model is much more focused. Taylor have spent the maximum amount of time making sure every model works, which in turn can only mean one thing: better guitars. Part of making amazing guitars with robots isn't just about how you program them. It's also about learning when not to use them.
Some people are shocked, especially kind of advanced manufacturing personnel, when they come into our factory and they'll point at different things and say, why haven't you automated this? There's often a very good reason, and usually the number one reason is wood. So, and I was the same way. I walked into this place and I thought I was going to like just boom, boom, pointing out things like we're going to do this and this and this. And 7 years later, and I'm just so glad we didn't. And so that's often my job, is just investigating something to see, can we do this better? Can we do this with a machine? And oftentimes my job is to say, no, we can't.
So what can't a robot do at Taylor?
So, you know, finished sanding is something that is really, not only is it tough to do with a robot, because A, our finish is, you know, 7 thou thick, so 7 mils thick. It takes a very definitive touch, but at the same time that you're creating that finish quality surface at the end of it, whether it's the neck, whether it's the body, whether it's the headstock, you're creating it to be touched. What criteria do you want to say this is good or not? Do you want it to feel good? Well, when somebody is finishing that by hand, they're feeling it as they go. You know, they're building in a quality step. We check it later on, of course, but as they're working, they are providing that feedback as they're working. So to build that feedback into a robotic system, although they're very repeatable, you need to provide accurate motion based on a feel. And that's tough. That's really tough. Not impossible, but very tough. Final string up and setting up of a guitar as well. That's, again, it's the final step to give someone something to play. If someone can set up a guitar well in a high-end guitar shop, we should be able to set up a guitar well in a high-end guitar factory, especially when there's so many string gauges, there's different action we have for different models or different neck widths, and you know, there's so many variables with that. Could you do it? Yeah. Do you want to do it? That's a business case.
We've covered a lot of ground with Taylor's processes. We've learned why they use robots in the first place, the challenges they face, and the unexpected benefits of manufacturing guitars in this way. So now, let's have Tyler explain to us what robots there actually are in Taylor's factory.
The first robot that the guitars would see is our spraying robot. A bunch of stuff happens there in our finish department, spraying, sanding. At the point that the finish is to the thickness and to the quality and prep state that we would be ready to buff a guitar, then it would go to our buffing robots. There's two buffing robots, but you generally just put a guitar in one. So it only sees one of those robots. It gets buffed. That takes about 10 to 15 minutes, depending on the model. There's an amount of hand buffing that we'll do depending on the model, some detail work. There's some aspects that we just say, we're gonna do that parts by hand because of the variance or the decisions that someone has to make, where the robot handles the bulk of the work. The guitar neck, early on in the process, there's a robot that applies adhesive. And we did that both to control the amount of adhesive we were using, because it was an expensive glue, and apply it in the same way every time, because also it was a very strong adhesive. So we wanted to make sure that that was applied with regularity, and we get the repeatability of a robot. So guitar neck sees robots, guitar sees an adhesive robot, guitar body sees a spraying robot and a buffing robot. We put those two things together, neck and body. At that point, if the guitar is getting electronics, we have three robots involved in the manufacture of our electronics. Those three robots work to create the pickup system, and then that goes into the guitar.
Not only do Taylor's robots offer all the benefits already discussed in this video, but as you can probably tell from Tyler's explanation, there's a level of efficiency that is unmatched in the production. Different parts of the guitar are worked on simultaneously thanks to their designs, and materials such as expensive glues aren't wasted. Aside from robots, Taylor are always using technology to streamline their process. Not only do Taylor use bespoke, tailor-made robots in their production, there are also a plethora of other automated machines and custom tools that economize on time whilst also improving the quality of job that they can do at every point of the build process. We previously mentioned that Taylor has to take extensive time to plan out how every different material, model, and shape runs through every different machine. But how do they keep track of all of that different information at so many different points of the factory where there's a different worker at every stop controlling machinery?
Our RFID tags, which we use throughout the factory, can indicate what type of wood is in which guitar, which can then allow us to choose different programs.
We've got a sticker right here, and this is actually a radio frequency ID tag, RFID. The body, the guitar, and the neck get RFID stickers on them, and that actually will be encoded with information for that particular model. So it's got everything from the serial number to all the specifications for that guitar, and that allows that guitar to be tracked through production. So at different stations, we've got scanners that we can basically scan that tag, and it pulls up all the information about that guitar. And actually, it will document some of the progress. So our craftspeople, as they complete something, they may scan it and document the work that they did or what happened there. So it's, by the time we get a guitar through production, it actually has an entire work history associated with it. And that the tag will actually, that'll stay inside the guitar.
And so a big project that we had was developing the database of guitar criteria or guitar parameters. You know, what makes a 314 CE in 2022 different than a 314 CE in 2018? Sure, sometimes we will switch wood with different models for limited series or something like that. So we have to keep track of those changes, and we have to drive some process changes. So something as simple as binding on the outside of the guitar. Faux tortoiseshell, it's much less susceptible to heat than some other plastics. So in a process that might, you know, by sanding or something else that generates a lot of heat, you have to be careful with it. So with buffing, we have a separate program for models that get the faux tortoiseshell bindings. So just something simple like that. Well, if now you're driving machine process off the parameters that go with that guitar, you have to have access to it, and that's where the RFID come in.
You need to build a process. You need to have the design. You need then your ability to make the design, but that means you need a process, you need a tool, you need a thing. You need an environment that you can create around it to control all those variables so that you do something not accidentally, but you do it on purpose. You don't accidentally want to build a good guitar because that means that the next guitar might accidentally be bad. You want it to be good on purpose because you made it to be good.
So, Taylor's exploits in robotics and designs make things easier, faster, more precise, more efficient, safer, consistent. We could go on. What's really special about Taylor's relationship with the technology it uses is the symbiotic relationship their products have with their build process. One can only exist alongside the other. And because of that, Taylor's guitars hugely benefit on all fronts. The robots at Taylor's factories are extremely helpful guitar builders, allowing the humans in the company to focus more effort on making the best guitars they can possibly make. And as long as they don't become sentient, everything is going to be just fine.
This is where the nickname Buffy for our robotic buffers comes from. because the first attempts to buff a guitar, and it had nothing to do with the fact that it was a Motoman robot, that's just a means to an end. It was the approach to what we were to buffing a guitar with a robot was a little skewed. So apparently there was a lot of guitars destroyed early on, so it was called Buffy the Guitar Slayer, and that was the first iteration of a buffing robot that we had put together.
We heard about Buffy the Guitar Slayer.
Buffy the Guitar Slayer. Yeah, first generations of those were pretty spooky, and she knew there was artificial intelligence even back then, because Buffy only did that when there was journalists around.
Well, everyone has to start somewhere. Thank you so much for watching our third installment in our video series about Taylor guitars. We really hope that you find these videos insightful and educational. And if you've enjoyed them, please make sure to give them a like and subscribe. We'll be making more videos like this, so make sure to keep an eye out on our channel. Until the next one, we'll see you soon.